met 15 women here today, and I can tell you that when I reached out to these women to say, hey, would you be willing to come to this event, there was not any hesitation. Everybody jumped on the bandwagon and was like, I am so passionate, whatever these girls need. So what I will tell you as a takeaway, please, please, please take advantage of the 15 women you met here today. This is a starting point. Reach out to them, ask them questions. That's what we're here for. So just think of this as the beginning of the journey, not the end. Like, I've met these women and bye, I'll never see them again. No, no, no. They are ready. They are ready, willing, and able to help answer any questions you have, provide advice, insights, you know, network with you. So please do take advantage of it. But in the meantime, I want to introduce our esteemed panel here. I'm going to ask the panel to come on up to the podium here. Hopefully we won't trip as we're walking up, but all right, everybody. You're coming on up.
Come on, ladies.
I'm going to sit in the middle so you guys each have your own microphones. Before we get started with some of the questions and answers, is just introduce you to this group of women here today. So I'm going to start all the way on the left with Libby Hurley. So Libby is a mom of three. She is a four-time Ironman finisher. I can't even say that without, you know. Ironman finisher. She's a former junior Olympian, and she's now the president of Together We Try. She's actually the co-founder. I should mention you're the co-founder. You are the only founder. You are the founder, and you are the president as well. So Libby has a passion for introducing people to the sport of triathlons. She encourages athletes of all fitness levels to believe in themselves through the journey of triathlon. She's also the author of Try the Journey. I know she's got her book here today, if anyone's ever interested. Now I'm going to pick it up and read it. And she's also a TEDx motivational speaker. If you haven't seen, if you've got time afterwards to take a look at some of what Libby's got out there, I got to tell you, Libby, I went out there and I was incredibly impressed. I got tears in my eyes. You are phenomenal. So take a look, go out on TEDx and take a look at some of her motivational speeches. So welcome, Libby. We're happy to have you. Okay, next on my left, we've got Dr. Trupti Gokhani. So she's an MD. She's an award-winning board-certified neurologist.
I know, right there.
Wow, okay, wow. And I should mention, this is not here about, but we should mention this. Do you know the stats? It's such a low percentage of women who are neurologists in the workforce, and I don't know the stat offhand, but at some point, you know, I did a little research on this, and ladies, it is a very, very small percentage of women who are neurologists. So she is definitely breaking that glass ceiling. So we're thrilled.
I can't even spell neurologist.
Yeah. So she's best known for her innovative and integrative approach to treating headache pain. Her unique melding of modern medicine and ancient wisdom has enabled her to establish a thriving practice along Chicago's North Shore. It's actually in Glenview. So for those of you, whoever want to pass by her clinic, it's phenomenal. This is where her patients seek her insights, and I really hope I pronounce this correctly, Dr. Bokhani, but Ayurveda. Is that right?
Correct, yes.
Ayurveda. Ayurveda neurology coach. This is basically the healing the head by healing the mind and the body. She is a sought-after trainer, speaker, and author of the 2015 book, The Mysterious Mind. Dr. Gokhani has lectured extensively in the field of neurology, psychiatry, specifically regarding headaches, mood disorders, insomnia, adrenaline fatigue, hormonal issues, and adult attention deficit disorder. She has spoken, wait till you hear this list, ladies. She has spoken at the American Headache Society, the Midwest Pain Society, the American Academy of Neurology, and the American Psychiatry Society. Her work on topics ranging from Botox efficacy and safety to the prevalence of bipolar disorder and cluster headache patients has been published in such esteemed journals as the American Journal of Pain Management. She's also published articles pertaining to food allergies and headaches, and along with Ayurveda approach to migraine in the well-regarded Journal of Headache. Dr. Gokhani's special interests include Ayurveda mind-body types, women's issues and headaches, yoga as a treatment modality, nutrition and pain, adrenaline fatigue, stress, the gut-brain connection, insomnia, and emerging non-traditional approaches to headache management in support of patients whose health issues can be effectively addressed through the incorporation of high-quality herbs and nutritions in their diets. She's developed, okay, so by the way, just let's recap here. So in addition, I just want to make sure, because as I was reading this, I'm like,
I hear them following.
Yeah, shut up. Just to recap here.
I don't sleep, you said.
Okay, yeah, just to recap. I just told you. She's a neurologist. She has her own clinic. She has published articles. She's done multiple speaking engagements. But that wasn't enough. It wasn't enough for her. She's developed a line of supplements that provide combinations and concentrations of support nutrients not available elsewhere in the market. When not in the clinic, working one-on-one with patients whose complaints range from debilitating migraines to chronic fatigue, Dr. Gokhani dedicates her time and significant insights to helping the wider community understand the purpose of their pain and how to heal themselves through a deeper appreciation of the mind-body connection. This, ready for this one? Okay, doesn't stop here, ladies. Dr. Gokhani was recently featured on Dr. Oz Show, and I should mention, will be on a show that's aired later today on Dr. Oz. So if you can remotely set up your...
Leave school at 1 o'clock.
Yeah, 1 o'clock. Leave school at 1. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I say that out loud? Oh. Yeah.
Okay.
But it's okay, right? We all have remote... Don't you all have, like, kind of remote DVR, like you can do it from your phone? I've learned that. There's a way to do it. Either that or call home or text home. Of course, when you're allowed to during school. You might want to record that episode. She is contributing to a health documentary that begins filming this fall and authored her first book, The Mysterious Mind. Dr. Tripti Gokhani earned her medical degree from the University of Illinois at Chicago, where she also completed her training in neurology. She was the chief resident, and she pursued additional postdoctoral training and certification as a master clinical psychopharmacologist. She has continued to educate herself for the benefit of her patients, gaining experience and credentials in Ayurveda medicine, clinical psychopharmacology, and transcendental meditation. She is certified by the American Board of Neurology and Psychiatry, and she's not only licensed to practice in Illinois, but she's also licensed to practice in California as well. Welcome, Dr. Gokhani.
I'm a little bit more boring, guys.
No, wait to hear Rachel's story, okay? By the way, I should mention, as I'm reading these biographies, you're probably thinking in your head, Well, they're not consistent. They're not meant to be ladies. This shows the diversity of who we've got here. And I'm not even saying consistent in terms of their backgrounds and what they've done. Even how they've written their bios, it shows you the uniqueness of their personalities. So ready for the uniqueness of Rachel's personality here? We're going to come out loud and clear. All right, here we go. Rachel Canning, formerly known as Rachel LeBron.
Any relationship to LeBron James?
Unfortunately not. So, this was new to me, ready for this? She was born and raised in Skevinston, Illinois. Has anyone ever heard of Skevinston, Illinois?
Nice!
Nice! It is on the border of Skokie and Evanston. Never heard of it. She clearly made it up. Okay.
I'll Google it, because I Googled it before I read it.
Rachel was raised as a single mom.
No,
Rachel was raised by a single mom. She was born in Puerto Rico and came to the United States at the age of 10, not speaking a bit of English. Okay, so imagine this. Her mother made no excuses and became fluent in English and eventually went on to receive her master's degree in accounting. Her mother was her hero and role model and believed the key to success was education and hard work. While Rachel's mother could have sent her to Evanston Township High School, she made the decision instead to send her a private all-girl Catholic school called Regina Dominican, which was a huge out-of-pocket investment for a single mom. So she worked hard to make sure she sent her daughter to the school. The change in environment altered Rachel's future and has shaped her in being the driven person she is today, which I can attest to. In 1997, Rachel was 29 when her mother died tragically of a brain aneurysm at the age of 50. She was left to raise her 13-year-old sister, while the only parent was gone. So she was raising her little sister. But Rachel remained determined not to give up on her dreams. Where there's a will, there's always a way. That's her philosophy. Rachel was a graduate of the University of Illinois at Chicago. She's a wife to an Iowa Hawkeye. She's the mother of four fun-loving children and owner of the cutest little chocolate lab named JoJo. And she is, as she mentioned earlier, she's the managing partner and co-founder of RL Canning Inc. Now, here's a little bit of, you know, I was laughing when I read this because I was like, I'm getting tired reading this actually, Rachel. She loves to do long runs, lift heavy weights, garden. I mean, is there something you can't do? I liked this though. She likes to drink yummy red wine. I didn't know if it was all red wine or just yeah, it has to be yummy. Yes. But Rachel did not engage in that until she was 21 years old. Now, she plays poker with her kids. She likes to travel, and this is my all-time favorite. She likes to sing in the shower. Yeah. You can sing out of the shower too, Rachel. All right. And she'd love to pick up the guitar again soon. So we might have a little guitar playing and singing, right? Okay. Perfect. So welcome. Thank you, Rachel. Okay, Lori Eshu. Lori is the founder of National Tax Treasure, otherwise known as NTS. She founded it in 1996. And today she serves as the president and CEO for NTS and its subsidiaries. She has 37 years of commercial and residential valuation experience and tax compliance experience from two points of views, ownership and consulting. Her experience in property tax consulting and real estate ownership management services have heavily aided in the overall growth of National Tax Search. I have to tell you, we met before we were on this panel, and it's phenomenal, the growth that you have at National Tax Search and how the company started with just a couple of people and where it's at today. And so we'll get into that. So she believes her keys to success in NTS's growth lie in superior customer service, provided to every client and the accountability of each product. In her first 15 years in the industry, Eshoo served as National Account Manager for Real Estate Tax Services and as a tax manager with VMS Realty Partners. During this integral time, Eshoo envisioned a cohesive blend service. And now listen to this, ladies, because I want to make sure this is called out. She was one of the first ones to think of this, of e-commerce back in the day. So she had that vision to develop e-commerce. That wasn't out in the marketplace yet. She was at the forefront. So that would enhance a property management consulting service, making it more efficient and effective. Through dedication and determination, Lori Eshoo brought her vision to life in NTS and TaxQ. Today, she still plays an integral role with the sales and client relations team, ensuring all clients serve the best service and support. Okay, now, here's the real plug. It's almost like too much to read of all the awards. Get this. Listen to all these awards she's won. put your hats on here. She has been recognized for her entrepreneurial spirit and innovating vision of TaxQ through Ernst & Young. She was the Entrepreneur of the Year in 2005. Realizing Business Potential, sponsored by Microsoft. Her other awards include 2005 and 2007 ABA Stevie's Award and the International Women's Entrepreneur in Technology and Best Entrepreneur in Business under 100 employees. Wow, quite an accomplishment. Welcome, Lori. We're glad to have you. Ladies, because I gotta tell you, when they agreed to be on the panel, it's like, how much could I learn? Because I gotta tell you, I'm so excited to learn from these amazing and impressive women here today in terms of how they got started in their journey and takeaway insights and advice. And I hope you feel the same way. So I'm up here learning just as much as each of you in the audience. So here's my ask to you. I'm gonna start asking them, some questions, and you'll hear some of the answers. What I'd like you to do is, you've actually got note cards at your table in the middle. They're the Chicago Bears note cards. Unfortunately, sorry, those are the only ones we had at home. So that's what you get. So what I'd like you to do is, we've got two ways of you asking the panelists questions. The first way is we can go ahead and have you stand up and ask the question if you'd like, or if you prefer, you can write down the questions and the women at the table will pass them up to us so we can ask these questions along the way, okay? Are we ready? All right, take down those insights. I'm taking notes, I've gotta tell you. I'm taking notes and I'm walking away with insights and advice for my future here. Okay, so Libby, I'm gonna start with you. Can you tell us a little bit about your personal journey? And I wanna hear the fun stuff too.
Okay.
All right.
All right, I grew up in Kentucky with two sisters, and I think I've shared with many of you that I was a very shy, quirky kid. I was a swimmer, and I preferred to be in the water over anything, so I didn't have to face talking to people. So I was very introverted growing up. Swimming took me to a semi-successful place. I used to swim 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours after school every day. I was a junior Olympian and an Olympic hopeful, but as soon as I was in college, I decided I was saturated with the pool. My poor parents, all the investment that they made in me for swimming, and when I get to college, I'm like, nah, I think I'm done. My kids better not do that to me. And then I wasn't sure what I wanted to do. I loved math and decided that I would go into medicine. So I'm a PA in neurosurgery and neuroresearch. So I did brain and spine surgery for many years. And then moved to San Francisco and felt like 70 hours of work week was not the life that I had wanted. I wanted children and was feeling a little down about the patients, feeling like I had this such vigor for life and was taking home kind of the sadness of the patient. So I was searching, looking for another direction, another way, and I had no idea. Here I had invested my time in medicine, and I had no idea what I wanted to do next. I was walking in San Francisco on Crissy Fields and saw The Escape from Alcatraz, and this was the first time that I'd ever seen a triathlon. I didn't even know what this was. So what were these people doing, getting out of the water and running to their bike and running off their bike? So I watched the entire race and literally was crying while everybody crossed the finish line. And everyone that crossed that finish line had that sense of just feeling so good about themselves, so good about that accomplishment. And I kept looking at each athlete thinking, I need to feel this. I need that. I haven't had that in my life in a long time. So I told my husband, next year I'm going to do this race. And he kind of laughed at me. I was an asthmatic child, so I never ran, and hadn't been on a bike since I was 10, but decided this is what I need. I need that awe feeling. So started training, and the next year arrived. I was dumped off in the water, 52 degrees in Alcatraz, or San Francisco Bay. Mile and a half swim in, 18-mile bike ride, 8-mile run, was one of the last to cross the finish line. But when I crossed, I saw the finish line. I was running, crying, hands up in the air, and then I saw the people looking at me as I was looking at the finishers last year. And it may not have been fast, it may not have been pretty, but I did it. And the I did it still gets to me, because I didn't think, gosh, wow, I'm emotional. I didn't believe in myself. So crossing that finish line just really made me realize that you can do anything that you put your heart, your soul, your hope into. So it changed my chemistry right there, that belief in me, and I knew that I needed to extend that experience to others. And so I started training some friends, and then we moved to San Francisco, to Chicago. There were no training companies, so I thought, okay, I'm going to start a triathlon training company. So I didn't have a plan, I didn't have a business plan, I had no idea what I was really doing, but I had a passion, a hope, and an idea. I walked into Lakeshore Athletic Club with a proposal and said, I want to start a triathlon training program. And each week, I may not have known what the athletes really were doing. It was kind of week to week, I would come up with the next plan. Long story short, first year, 16 women, next year 56 women, next year 112. We're at 9,000 athletes now, and it brought me to the place of being an author and being a TED speaker, as Rana has mentioned. So who knew that this asthmatic child would end up being a triathlete and spreading the joy of this journey? So that's my journey.
Great. Thanks, Libby.
How is all of it, right? Amazing. So heartwarming. So I think, what's interesting in my journey is that I was born in Kampala, Uganda. I'm of Indian descent, and we were kicked out of the country. I actually came here as a refugee. And what's really interesting is that I was only 9 months old. We came over here, I went to London first, and then made our way to Chicago. My mother, very early on, in my very early years, said, don't take life for granted. You just never know. And what's really important for you to do is to get educated. So early, I was really kind of encouraged to work hard and to develop a sense of a personal value. And she said, education's gonna give you that, because God forbid you have to leave, because we did have to leave Uganda very quickly, within 3 months. If you wanna learn about that, we can talk about that. Idi Amin was considered like the Hitler of East Africa. And bottom line, we left very quickly, and the only thing that we had was my dad had education. We didn't have any money. My dad was an internist in East Africa, came here and was able to get his residency position and practice medicine again. So early on, I was taught work hard, work hard, work hard. So I worked really hard in high school, really hard. I was kind of a perfectionist. And when I got to, I went to University of Illinois in Champaign, I was in the business school. And I was really happy being in the business school for the first about 3 to 4 months. as I continued in business school, I said, wait a second, I don't know if I like accounting and finance and all these classes. So I really loved econ, and I thought, maybe I'll shift out of business school, which is a big no-no when you're in the B school at U of I, and I'll go into LAS, liberal arts and science, and study economics and maybe biology, because I just wanted to have freedom. Well, my first piece of advice to all of you is follow your heart. Follow your heart. The I should, I must, don't let yourself be guided by that, because I should stay in B school. I should follow my path with something that was in the back of my mind, but deep within me was this craving to learn more than just business. So early on, I allowed myself to explore. And in Champaign, I studied economics, I studied Japanese drama, I studied all sorts of different things, and eventually made my way to medical school. Within medical school, within the first year, I had a lot of challenges with sleeping. I suffered with severe insomnia. I mean, it was so bad I was gonna leave med school. And again, in the back of my mind, I thought, okay, what is my deep mind saying I should do? Should I stay in med school? Should I not stay in med school? And I kind of gave myself a few weeks. I took a couple anatomy quizzes and said, if I fail these quizzes, I'm not gonna study. If I fail them, maybe that's a sign to leave, right? Well, I passed the quizzes and I made myself kind of allow myself to kind of stay in that place for a while. Well, during that journey, which is really important, I wanna bring this up to you. If you ever struggle, realize that within that struggle, there's a lesson. And in that struggle of that severe insomnia, I learned a really important thing. I learned that I could find a place within me to step out of that. And how did I do that? I started reading books. I started reading self-help books, like by Deepak Chopra and Andrew Weil. I was in the bookstores looking at all these books on how to kind of get yourself out of an insomnia pattern. And I learned about Ayurvedic Eastern medicine. I would have never learned that. I was in a first year med school program. There was no way I was gonna be reading those books because I had histology and anatomy and everything else. Well, what I'm gonna tell you is that was the best experience of my life, to be forced to learn something that I would have never learned on my own. And so I look back at that insomnia and say, thank God that happened. It allowed me to explore something unique about myself and something I loved, which is Eastern medicine. Fast forward to med school, I finished it. Thank God, I got through it. A little blood, sweat, and tears, but I got through it. Went to residency and eventually made my way through neurology. Why did I love neurology? I loved exploring the mind. I thought the mind was fascinating. And I thought, this is kind of cool. I had my own insomnia thing. I figured out how to fix it using Eastern medicine and thankfully not too much Western. I just took a little bit of Ambien and then unfortunately got into a car accident and said, okay, let me stick with the Eastern stuff. Yoga was what saved me. Saved me. I'm not kidding you. I still practice yoga 3 times a week. It allowed me to connect with my vision and who I was. So eventually I leave a residency. I'm applying for these different positions. I joined a beautiful neurology practice in Northbrook, and I was prescribing lots and lots and lots of medications for pain. And I thought, uh-oh, here we are. We're in a place where we're not feeling really good. You know, you get a little kind of uncomfortable in your seat. And I thought, I don't know if I like using narcotics and injections all the time. This is 15 years ago. 15 years ago, we used lots of kind of narcotic medications to kind of help pain. And I thought, I need to do something else. What else can I do? Oh, you remember that Ayurvedic, that Eastern medicine I did way back, I learned about when I was in med school? Maybe I can go and study that. So as I kind of learned more about Ayurveda, I realized I can get certified. So to kind of end this very long story, what I want to tell you is my journey has been somewhat erratic. Never, ever has it been well-paved. And I think about the Robert Frost poem about the two paths you can take, which direction, which path, the well kind of paved path or trail, or the one that's less traveled upon. And honestly, by no choice of my own, because of life's interesting kind of experiences, I took the path less traveled. But because of that, I've now opened my own Zero Mind and Body Center for over a decade. I've been running my own practice. I'm actually the chief medical officer and spokesperson for a company called Ancient Healthcare. I'm also the educational director for a company called Browtime, which creates programs for pharmaceutical companies to help them create better products. So we're not using so many narcotics for pain. So here I am now, and all I can say is allow yourself to follow your heart and just be okay with not knowing what the answers are.
Rachel, tell us a little bit about your journey.
Your card. Although I'm so loud, I think no one will have a hard time hearing.
Yeah, I think there was something
there.
Yeah.
Okay. Good morning, ladies. That was amazing, both of you guys, amazing. I just wanted to touch on, because does everybody know what it means to be a refugee? I was having this conversation, oddly, with my with my my stepdaughter, and we were having a conversation, you know, the political climate that we're in today about the whole refugee situation is a sensitive topic, but do you guys all know what that is? Is everyone clear on what that means? And, you know, I just wanted to make sure, because that's amazing. That is amazing. But my journey, I want to kind of piggyback on some of the things that the previous ladies were talking about. We all have different stories, right? So it's never, and when you talk about the struggle, what I finally learned in my elderly age is the struggle is where all the beauty takes place, guys. So before I used to, in high school, like, as I mentioned, my mom was a single parent. You know, it was kind of challenging. Glenbrook South is an amazing university with a lot of different economics involved to it. And some of you are really, really lucky to have such supportive parents that are encouraging you to push you along to be successful. So my journey, my mom did the best that she possibly could, right? So she was in cultures, like I see the diversity of women in here, but also culture plays a big role too. I'm of Hispanic descent. I don't know if there's any Hispanics in this room, but you're raised a little bit different. You're raised to hopefully get married, and there's nothing wrong with that, right? I am married. I'm very happily married and blessed to be so. But, you know, to get married and stay home and raise the family and play it safe, right? So I went to Regina, and when I went to Regina, I was exposed to a different world. I was exposed to the world of people that lived in Kenilworth, people that lived in Winnetka, people that lived in these beautiful homes, and I lived in my humble home, which was great. There was nothing wrong with it, but it wasn't to that same caliber in Skedenston. So when I had the opportunity to go to high school and be exposed to a different world, it really shifted me. It's like, holy moly, look at these houses. And I kid you not, when I was in high school, I would drive through some of these communities and go visit my friends, and I'd be like, I will live in a house like this. I will have a car like this. Wow, is this how other people live? And I thought it was so cool. And for whatever reason, there was something in me that was drawn to what I perceived, people that had great families, the mom, the dad, the chocolate lab. I'll have a chocolate lab, and I have a chocolate lab. You know, that have everything that I thought in my mind seemed, those rose-colored glasses seemed so perfect. And so then and this is what's really, really important, is that when I was in high school, I was drawn to really high-performing friends. So all my girlfriends were in AP classes. All my girlfriends, you know, played sports and did all these amazing things. And I fostered some incredible friendships. This is really important, ladies. The people that you hang out with, their parents, they are watching you. Everyone is watching you. Not in a bad way, like, always feel like somebody's watching you. Not like that. But in a way, people are watching you. People are kind of like, huh, it's a good kid. Or, huh, kid seems like a knucklehead. Or whatever, they're watching you. And the reason why I mention this is that when I graduated from Regina, my friends went off to all these incredible universities. I had to pay for my own college. So I went to the University of Illinois, Chicago. I had to pay for that, and I had to figure it out. So I had to work and put myself in college. However, I maintained all my friendships while I was in high school, and my first job out of school was with a company called Fort Howard, and the reason why I got that job was that the Donnelly family lived in Winnetka. Mr. Donnelly was first generation successful businessman from Belgium, and he goes, Rachel, you got a lot of great kid. When you get out of college, look me up. You know what? I want to open a door for you. I'm like, I'm gonna hold you up to that. So I did. And Mr. Donnelly opened up the door, and I never had a interview or for a job ever again, because I worked really hard. I had to. I wasn't like a highly academic kid. You know, I didn't have that perfect pedigree. I didn't have a plan B. I had to go with plan A. So I got my first job out of college. I sold toilet paper, ladies. That's right. Don't tell me you don't use it. I sold it. Right out of college, I was walking up and down the streets of the city of Chicago selling TP. I'm going to keep going here really quick and just kind of wrap it up. But now, moving forward, there was a lot of journey in there, and I know we're running out of time. But today, I pinch myself that I'm a co-founder of an IT consulting company. That's a whole other story. I know nothing about IT. I am the business development person, I know you're really shocked, of the organization. So I'm that person that goes in, and talked to Fortune 500 companies, and I talked to them about managed services within the IT space. And so today we have a global organization with roughly about 300 employees working with Fortune 500 services, working with Fortune 500 companies and selling them IT consulting services. So there's a lot in there. It's very colorful, it's really gritty, but don't be afraid because fear drives you. So thanks, guys.
To reiterate some of what has already been talked about in our other team members here, and I know we have a little bit of time left, but again, coming from somewhat of the same background, single mother of four kids, really didn't have an opportunity right out of high school to enter into college, needed to go to work to build myself up to then go away. By doing that, I actually was introduced to the world I live in today, but at 17, I had no idea what property taxes were all about. So I was introduced to some very national and international commercial real estate company, some mentors today who are still friends of mine after 33 years of business. And again, staying in touch with all of the contacts that you meet throughout your life is very, very important. Being very positive and interested in learning everything you can about what you are doing in life and keeping a positive attitude and believing in yourself is key to the success of where you go in life. And if I can say anything, growing up with a single mom, learning about what she struggled with, it's important for us as women to believe in yourselves and continue on with that in your journey of your life. As you get married, as you have kids, do not lose yourself in that entire journey that you're going through. You can always have a partnership with your husband and your family, but continue to believe in yourself. It's important as you build, as you move through your life, and as you teach your children to stay strong and positive. So everything that has been discussed today, again, it's stay positive, build on relationships, learn as much as you can, go for your dreams, and you will all be successful in your lives and happy as you grow.
Thank you, Lori. Okay, if I can just have the panel, I know we're short on time, so just one quick, we're okay? Okay, what I'd like from each of you is to reflect upon, you know, advice you'd give your younger self, right? And advice you'd give to all of the ladies here today, what would that one piece of advice be? Libby.
How come I always have to go first?
Sorry. I can switch it up.
No, my younger self, to not should all over myself. I should do that. Not care as much what other people think, and to really believe in myself as my own person, my own dreams, my own wishes, my own hopes, and to not let fear burden you. We all have fear, but just take that little step, just walk through the fear, and you'll see that each step will take you closer to your heart, to your love, to your center, and to your journey.
Thank you, Libby.
Beautiful. And kind of to go with that, I have a little quote. I would say something like this to myself. The most valuable thing you can make is a mistake. You can't learn anything from being perfect. And I wish I had told myself that because I was such a perfectionist. Just allow yourself to flow, make some mistakes, have some fun. Life is not meant to be so serious. So just have fun, enjoy, follow your heart, and see what happens.
Thank you. Rachel.
Well, I'm not a perfectionist.
I know, I could learn a little bit. I'm the wingmaster. But I
kind of wrote some of this down too. Some of the things I'd say to myself is, never say I can't. Guys, never, ever say I can't. Say I can, and I will. Okay? Never say I can't. The other thing I want you to know is I want you to also know that if you're not uncomfortable, then you're not pushing yourself. You have to be uncomfortable. I was just in a meeting the other day. I was sweating down my back, down my front. I was completely uncomfortable. Be uncomfortable. The other thing is don't ever, oh, this is a huge one. And I just learned this, okay? I'm old and I just learned this. Don't have a limited mindset. As an example, I love CrossFit, and there's this woman in her 40s that does CrossFit with me. I'm past that, but she is like this little tiny thing, and she is amazing. And she literally, after the end of her workout, looked at me and goes, "Suck it up, Rachel. You are so shortchanging yourself because you're stronger than you give yourself credit for." And I'm like, "Oh, I'm going to get you, girl, next time." So don't limit your mindset. And last but not least, I just want to say that support each other as women. Yeah. Support each other as women. Please, can we not be catty, ladies? Can we not look at what the Joneses have? It's ridiculous. If you choose to have a career, good for you. If you choose to stay home and raise your kids, good for you. Support the women that stay home. Support the women who go to work. Support each other.
Okay, I'm going to add a little different. Everything that has been said is correct. Work hard and learn as much as you can with what you're working with. Dress for success. Every job is different. You need to read your audience and understand really what that role means in dressing for success for the business that you're in. Always go the extra mile. Do not just do the job that you have been given. Show them that you're interested in learning. Don't be afraid to try something new. And as an employer in a world of technology today, I would say if you're working, put your phones down. Show that you are interested in the work that and environment that you're doing. And of course, everybody has a phone, but put them down so that everybody, your employer, knows that you are focused on the job you are there to do today.
All right, thank you so much. One thing I'll mention is, I know we didn't get to your questions, and I apologize. Keep those questions, ladies, because you can absolutely circulate it to this group of ladies. They will come back. They will answer your questions. So please do keep those.
Let's give our guests a round of applause.
Ladies, we'd also like you to take the mug that's at your table. That symbolizes our belief in you, the potential that you have. We want you to change the world. We will share information so you can reach out to these ladies. This is just the first step. If you have questions about courses, the whole faculty is listed on your program, and we would love to see you again soon. Thank you.
Ladies, do something great.
Yeah. Go get them, girls.